Today I have a million wacky demos to show. Let's see, because I'd like to talk about how motors work. Actually, we're going to be getting to how Arduino can be used to control your robot. How many people have played with motors and which types so far? What kind of motors have you played with?
DC brushless.
All right. Yeah. DC brushless.
That's interesting.
Yeah. So there's a million different types. Actually, I think the simplest one has two wires. This is the I don't know if these are visible. Is it visible? Nope. So there's two wires in the back of this motor, and then I got a red wire and a black wire coming off. So this is what's called a brushed DC motor. So if I get the colors correct, I've got a little PC power supply. Let's see. You can hotwire a PC power supply to run without a motherboard if you ground out the green wire with a paper clip. Not totally safe. I've got a little voltage monitor so we can see that see how much basically volts and amps that go through here. Now, does it matter if I get the black and the red matched up? Possibly. So I'm gonna start by matching up black and red, and then just see what happens. So I don't know if you can see what's happening there. So, okay, yeah.
Spinning.
So we're spinning, and we're spinning, clockwise? I think it's clockwise. This is super duper dangerous. I'm flipping the polarity. So reverse the polarity, which is the usual sci-fi way to get something different to happen, and it's going counterclockwise, hopefully. Is that counterclockwise? Yes. So it spins the other way, which actually is not that bad. So a two-wire motor actually has this nice behavior where if you plug it in backwards, it'll just spin backwards, which seems surprisingly like reasonable. Most other stuff. So if I have like an Arduino and I hook up the power to where the ground should be and the ground to where the power should be, it stops being an Arduino. And it either becomes like a smoke emitter, or it just ceases to do anything interesting ever again, which is kind of depressing. So let's see. So if I hook up to the on a PC power supply, the yellow wire has 12 volts, and the red wire has 5 volts. So here I'm on the red wire, and you can see the motion is a lot more sedate, sort of nice and slow. And if I go to the yellow wire, definitely a lot more excited. So what does this tell you about how a DC motor, brushed DC motor, changes with voltage?
It's more voltage equals more speed, and negative voltage equals negative speed.
Yeah. So in particular, there's actually this beautifully linear relationship between volts and speed, where basically I look at the motor speed, I look at the voltage that I'm sticking in, and it's a straight line. And maybe there's a little flat spot around zero. I don't give it enough volts, it doesn't turn at all. But basically, like, positive voltage gives you more speed. Now, a straight line is great, because a straight line, we can extrapolate as far as we want in either direction, right? And nothing will ever go wrong with a straight line. So, for example, if I take this motor, right, and we saw it, 12 volts, it spins, you know, at a pretty respectable clip, and you say, hey, I have a giant, truck-sized robot. I need to drive it with this motor. So you can just figure out how many volts you need, and it's maybe 1,000. So you're like, that's cool. Put in 1,000 volts. What happens to this motor?
It melts down.
It turns into a glob of molten goo. Right? Because all linear things eventually break down, particularly for DC motors. At some point, basically, your speed is going to kind of trail off, right? It doesn't really matter what is going to happen. And then, oh my gosh, something weird is going to happen. The motor is going to melt, for example. And then same deal if you turn backwards. Actually,
the installation itself has a voltage.
What's that?
The installation itself has a voltage.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. So this is a bigger motor, and it's actually usually just got a slightly different slope. Like at 5 volts, this thing maybe barely turns. So let's try this out. And so I've got... this thing works exactly the same. There's two terminals on the back, and the cool part is we marked it red, and that's just so we remember which direction it turns. Actually, having the motor, the parts of the robot turning the opposite direction you expect when you give them the same command, it really sucks. So all I'm doing is I'm going to try and jumper this thing up to work properly. And I'm going to put on safety glasses. So what do you expect to have happen here? So if I had two big jumpers, I would be using two big jumpers. I only have the one big jumper. So what do you expect to have happen? So I think. So I don't know. There's lots of options. It's the same 12 volts we were driving the other motor at, which seemed to actually be okay. This motor, believe it or not, if you read the data sheet, is rated for 12 volts, which is cool. So here's what happens when I plug this in. So you may only get to see this once. Did you hear it? It spun. But it doesn't. It's not continuing to spin. Oh, and look at my current monitor. So something interesting happened here, which is that the power supply is 12 volts. So this is like a PC power supply. I mean, there's nothing too exciting happening here. PC power supply is 12 volts. This is a 12 volt motor. Sounds like you should be able to hook those up. What's the problem with a PC power supply, which is, it's actually 12 volts, but it's a little bit gentle. Actually, this is kind of a crappy power supply. It's possible a giant gamer power supply would have survived this. So let's see. So if you look on the back of the PC power supply, they've always got current ratings. So for example, in the 12 volt rail, this thing only will do 9 amps, which is actually, it's actually probably why it's in my parts bin rather than sitting in a computer. Like I had to. 9 amps, 12 volts. So it's 100 watts on the 12 volt rail, which, peak output, this is a 100 watt power supply. Yeah.
I think my home power supply is like 50 amps or something on 12 volts.
Yeah. So the problem with this power supply is not the volts, it's the amps. What are volts and what are amps?
Fancy electrical terms for how the electrons are flowing.
So if electrons are flowing through a wire like water's flowing through a pipe, what's the voltage?
Potential energy difference.
Potential. What's potential energy in a pipe?
High.
Okay, so if it's 12 volts down here, it'll be 18 volts up here.
Yeah.
But,
think about it. The higher the voltage, harder slammed into the ground from that height, right?
So to me, the direct analog between water flowing through pipe and electrons flowing through wire, voltage in electrons is pressure in a pipe, right? So it turns out water has this really strong influence of gravity. So like the taller the pipe, and the more pressure you get at the bottom. Electrons are light enough that gravity doesn't do a whole lot to electrons. Actually, conceivably, this makes me think there's an awesome experiment. If you had a wire with a lot of current flowing through it going uphill versus going downhill, is there a difference? Because the electrons have to,
work. Test it up to orbit or something.
I think it's negligible. density of electric flow is pretty small. Yeah. And the mean velocity of the electrons is actually pretty low, too. There are definitely differences here. Actually, the big difference between pipe and wire is that if there's a leak in the pipe, the water sprays out in all directions. Whereas you notice here, we have this actually seems kind of deeply unsafe if you're used to working in AC. Like the ends of, there's just bare metal on the ends of these little, the wires. And it's because air is a pretty good insulator for electricity, but it's a good conductor of water. And it's just the difference between those things. So we got voltage. What's amperage?
That'd be the flow of the amount.
Yeah, for electricity, it's the number of electrons per second. And for water, it'd be the gallons per minute or something. Flow rate, basically. How about inductance? What is inductance?
Is there actually a good?
Turns out there is, yeah.
Turbulence
is a little more like resistance or something like that. So in electricity, what is inductance even? Stunned silence.
Resistance against change?
Inductance is, it fights DIDT, like change in the current. What is it? That's actually inertia, right?
Inertia.
And so interesting thing about pipes, actually, if you've done work on houses and stuff, but pipes, it's actually hard to avoid water hammer. So water hammer is where, like, I open my tap and I get this flow, right? Because there's a potential difference, so I get a flow of water coming out my tap, and you slam the tap off, then basically the inertia of the water moving the pipes, like, slams against the and you get actually a pressure spike. In other words, so exact same thing happens here. So if I have a bunch of current, actually in particular for this one, it's got great big windings, right? And as soon as I hook up current, a bunch of current actually starts flowing through the motor windings. And that's cool, everything's fine until I basically let go a little bit, and then all of that current actually basically slams against the other end and will actually make a big voltage spike. And so I have killed more devices by running electric motors than anything else. And it turns out there's essentially just a lot of inductance in the coils on a DC motor, because it's a coil. Actually, a device that does nothing but basically do inductance for you is just a little coil of wire. So if you compare that to, let's see, so we've got, so it turns out this device actually has a ton of inductance, and that means at 12 volts, it actually, you know, it produces a lot of, like, noise, and anytime I basically switch a brush DC motor on and off, and B, it just requires a bunch of amps. So we can figure out how many amps by looking at the resistance. So hopefully, so my PC power supply is not dead forever, hopefully. So I'm unplugging it, and at some point it should reset itself. One nice part about a PC power supply, it's sort of like internally protected against short circuits, over voltage, under voltage, over current, under current, like, you name it, right? It's actually.
Did they use a fuse or a self-resetting circuit breaker?
They call it a crowbar circuit, which is old terminology for me. You have the rack of electrical connections, and you're like, we really need to power everything off. You throw your crowbar into the rack of electrical connections, and it shorts it all. And that's like the emergency power off. It hits the crowbar circuit, and it's actually like a software controlled thing, I think, in the PC power supply's controller. The big problem with motors is they have really big inductance, and there's a lot of, like, inertia. This is a different component than this. Let's see, I need a higher res camera. So this is a little black steel can, and it's just got two wires coming off. So what possible components could that be? I mean, two wires tells you it's some kind of simple, like, you know, I push current flip through one way or another. So I'm going to measure the resistance, hopefully. I don't know if this is visible at all there. It's totally invisible. Basically, 14 ohms is the resistance I get out of there. So that's a pretty high resistance. That's cool. So what happens if I put this thing up to 12 volts? So do I have 12 volts? Come on. Okay, cool. We get power again. So 12 volts, 14 ohms. Ohm's law.
Uh-oh, he's putting on the safety glass.
Yeah. Well, I've never actually done this before, so this may be interesting. So, in particular, how much current do I expect to flow through this thing? Yeah. So it's so actually, if you make the numbers easy, call it 12 volts. It's not quite. Call it 12 ohms. It's not quite. I should get like 1 amp. 1 amp, pretty reasonable amount of current. So this thing is actually measuring current draw. So if I just, and this is kind of dangerous to just hook these things up this way. So I'm, it's actually hard for me to get a reliable connection. Okay, so it's probably totally invisible from where you're sitting, but basically 0.8 amps, because it was 14 ohms instead of 12 ohms. So okay, that's cool. And this actually also reports the watts, and it's about 10 watts. Now, I bought these things on eBay. This is a cartridge heater. It's actually just a little high power resistor, and it's toasty. It's not like sticking itself to my fingers or melting down. It's 10 watts. When I bought them on eBay, they were listed as 40 watts. Have I been cheated? Being eBay, it's not out of the question at all.
Were they listed for 40 watts? Voltage.
There's the important question.
For 24 volts.
So, if you look written on the case, there's hard to see. These are 24 volt, 40 watt heaters. In other words, they're supposed to run at 24 volts. I ran them at 12 volts. What happens?
You get one quarter of the power.
Well, it turns out a resistor has a volts versus amps curve that really is pretty much linear until it melts down. So that's cool. That's handy. And in particular, if I drive a resistor at half as many volts, I get half as many amps flowing through. So it seems like there should be half as much. So this should be 20 watts at 12 volts?
Except wattage is volts times
yes.
amps.
So the power is actually the product of the horizontal axis and the vertical axis, and they're linearly related. So it turns out with the resistor, there's a voltage squared aspect happening. So if I run it at half as many volts, I get half as many amps, and each amp is going through half as much potential drive. So that means I get a quarter as much power. So it turns out, if I ran this at 24 volts, then I would really get 40 watts, which is cool. I'll pass this around because I don't. So this works, and clearly the PC power supply works to do this kind of stuff. So let's see. So I'm going to go back down the road, the insulation is like a rubbery silicone stuff with I think glass, woven glass. I mean, it's not plastic, so that everything can get really hot. So we have this mystery, like what the heck happened with this, right? Like just plugging this into the power supply, like caused the power supply to just crowbar. Why?
Because you have an inrush current where the moment you start, you plug it in, you go to start it up, it demands, it acts almost like a short circuit.
Yep.
That's why a lot of motors.
This is also eBay. So I've got it in the ohm setting, and it reads basically 1 ohm when I just plug the leads together. So 1 ohm is kind of just the resistance in the leads. It's higher than it should be. Let's see. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to measure the coil resistance on this thing, and I get 1.2. So that's believe it or not, that's actually about accurate. So this is about 0.2 ohms resistance in the coil. How many amps at 12 volts?
0.2.
But 0.2 is 1/5. So if I divide by 1/5, that's multiplying by 5. This little thing will suck down 60 amps. Like, I've seen it pull down 80, actually. 80 amps is way more than 10 amps. And this is why, essentially, as soon as I plug this thing in, it's actually not even there's two big reasons that DC motors kill PC power supplies. One is the sort of raw amp draw is huge, like enormous. In particular, you gotta ask yourself this question, like, okay, if it's pulling like 60 amps at 12 volts, that's like 700 watts or something, right? And volts times amps gives me watts. So 700 watts is like, hair dryer like levels of power, and this is a pretty small device that has a little tiny little fan. So what's the deal there?
It only does that momentarily.
Yeah. Weird thing about this is that we have totally caused these motors to melt down at 12 volts. The way you do it is you have enough giant robot that they don't turn. If they don't turn, you're just sitting there doing the static like measurement, and the static current is ridiculous. Like basically all the amps you can get out of your system. So I guess 10 amps or a piece of power supply is not enough. Connectors are super important. I really like these are Anderson connectors, kind of my standard for how to do DC connections. There's a couple of different versions. It's way better than the ball of wires. So what I put this thing up to is a lithium battery, and let's see, I don't know if this is visible. These are actually fairly cheapo batteries, so they are, it's 5,000 milliamp hours, or 5 amp hours, so they'll do 5 amps for something like an hour and then die. I actually keep one in my glove box for that very reason. 20C, so This is sort of weirdly battery specific. So what this means is that the peak draw is 20 times the battery's capacity. So capacity is 5 amps. 20 times that capacity is 100 amps, which actually is, so you can see that, you know, they're fairly cheap batteries. This is 10 gauge wire. This is fairly, you know, pretty beefy wire. Actually, my connectors are probably, it's probably pushing it to do 100 amps through there. So theoretically, this should, so what's the self-protection built into the batteries?
A fuse if you're lucky.
Their self-protection is like, emitting smoke and flame as an indication of error. And, seriously, if the battery catches on fire, we should all leave, like, pretty quick. Because there's an ionic liquid in here that has a lot of fluorine, and fluorine compounds are really, really bad to breathe. So, ideally we'd have, like, a fume hood and gas mask and, Hopefully it's not going to die. Hopefully we're not going to die. But seriously, if you you'll know that there's an error because I'm screaming and running. So you should do the same thing. And this sort of stuff is a lot easier if you have some sort of way to do switches. So let's see. So I'm at the moment just holding the wires against the terminals here. Okay, so. Mostly you'll be able to hear it, and then we'll be able to get an amp draw. So, okay, are we ready? 3, 2, 1. That doesn't sound too bad. It's pulling 1 amp. 1. Not 60. Now the question is, like, what the heck? Did we, are we confused by Ohm's law here?
I said it was in, it's the inrush current.
So, like I say, we have flamed those things out. Let's see, the peak amp draw was only 3. That's interesting. So what the heck? So we have this mystery now. Like, at 12 volts, this should pull like 60 amps, and it pulled 1. It 1 amp should have kept that PC power supply alive, and apparently something interesting happens when you plug this thing in, right? And that's that. Basically, the static configuration where I'm just measuring the resistance through the coils and stuff stops being the limiting factor. And so the transformation that occurs here is that I am no longer just pushing electricity through a resistor, right? What I'm pushing electricity through here is a big coil of wire which has inductance, right? And in particular, inductance really saves your butt on a lot of these things. So the inrush current you'd think would be just 60 amps, just like boom. And in practice, the inductance actually means that, you know, I've got all this sort of, you know, it's like electrical inertia wanting to slow down the change in current there. So basically, I'm slow. So inrush current is actually tempered by the inductance. Now, if the rotor is locked, right, and if this thing can't spin, basically, you know, the inductance saves you for a fraction, you know, a few milliseconds or something, and then it'll rise up to 60 amps. And that current is flowing through this wire. You get these coils. So to understand why we're pulling less current, you kind of got to know what's inside the motor here. So here's what's inside the motor is flashy colors and magical changing things. How many people have built a motor? All right, one person. So inside a motor, it's actually pretty simple. So all we're doing, and I've got hopefully this wacky thing still works. This is two paper clips, a AA battery, and a little coil of wire. I don't know how close I can get to this. Okay, sure. So this is great. So I got a little rechargeable AA. This is just one of these impossibly strong neodymium magnets stuck to the steel case of the thing. I've got these are basically just, I think they're safety pins. Seem like they spun a little bit better. And then I've got some wire. So I've done, so the idea is basically the electricity comes out of one of the safety pins, goes up, we're going to have some sort of brush connection to go through the wire. We got a coil of wire. So the theory is like moving electrons through a coil of wire makes a magnetic field that's going to push against the magnetic field that's already on there. And we have a coil of wire, and this is just literally like some magnet wire. So it's insulated on the outside. It's got this little orange kind of like lacquer coating on there. So the obvious question is there enough amps coming out of the this AA? AA has a surprising number of amps. It's only like 1.5 volts, but it'll do an amp or two. And then there's one trick to making this work. One side of this wire is totally like scraped clean, so there's no insulation on this side. So this is basically just hooked up to the battery. And then the other side is scraped clean only on one side, but not on the other side. So let me see if I can get this to work. And always hard to tell. So at some point, the hope is that we see a... Oh, okay. So I don't know if you can see it. I'm getting like lots of little momentary connections that make the thing actually move. But it's not quite spinning. This thing tends to be... I can definitely feel the... the battery's heating up. I don't know if you can see there's little like arcing happening in there. It's gotten so hot that it's overheated. And I have a bunch of spare batteries. You can see, okay, there we go. Magical. And I have to push the brushes over into the right orientation or it stops working. That is the only thing that's happening there. So does this make sense? So basically the electrons are, it's a crap ton of electrons. It actually kills the battery in like a few minutes of operation. Electrons flowing through the battery, and electrons are coming out of the battery, going through the coil of wire, and why do we need this deal with the half of it is insulated and half of it isn't? Because otherwise you have an electromagnet, and it basically just sucks down, like the coil just wants to stick to the magnet or repel from the magnet, and that's it. So what we're setting up is like the, so commutation is what they call this ancient term. You're actually switching the magnetic field on and off to kind of keep the, you're basically trying to keep the, so there's two parts here. This is the stator, because it's static, doesn't move. This is the rotor, because it rotates. You can put the wires on either side here, and different trade-offs to make there. The brush DC motor usually puts the wires are on just the rotor, and then that means we actually need these brushes to basically get current into the rotor. So the brushes are actually what's doing the commutation here, and they're basically switching the current flow on and off in the little coil of wire. To make it, you know, sometimes it'll so the idea is basically when we're lined up. We're basically going to send juice through the coil, so it's going to pull down and want to face toward the permanent magnet in the stator, and then we just turn the field off, and then the whole thing keeps rotating, and then we turn it on again when it goes through the right spot. Now, if you get the commutation wrong, basically like you leave the coil on and it wants to just like stop, it wants to just hang on there. Surprising thing about this is that basically like usually there's not just one coil like our little example here. There's like a couple of different coils, and you just have you have more segments on the brushes where they're just going to activate the coils that are facing where they're going to get traction off of the static field in the inside here is exactly the same thing, and basically okay, so eventually this will kill the battery. So I mean it's a stupidly simple thing. I'll pass this around so you can see how little there is. There's a 3D printed magnet holder. It's a little thing under there. If you can get it to spin, that's good. If not, it's a little tricky to get the thing running.
Well, you also have to do. You got to give it a boost. I mean that's one of the things where permanent magnets they actually set a little bit. They set them off. They have them offset just a little bit. so that they always turn the same direction.
So there's a couple of really wacky things about this. So there's a static magnetic field, because so they have some permanent magnets. They're actually, these are like cheapo ceramic magnets, not neodymiums in this kind of motor. So the static magnetic field on the outside, that's basically just like a really strong vertical magnetic field. And then the brushes are setting up the coils so that basically the coils are wanting to do a field that's like 90 degrees off. So it starts to rotate it's repelled by the same north poles and it's attracted by the opposite poles. And it's going to try and rotate the rotor until it lines up. And then the brushes just set it up so, as soon as we stop getting power to one set of coils, we switch to the next set of coils. And it just, it's continually switching the coils. So weird part about this is that you're always lighting up new coils, and in particular, like the brushes are energizing a new set of coils that didn't have electricity flowing through them before, which means that when this thing is spinning at its maximum speed, you're mostly fighting the inductance of getting more current through the next set of coils. And basically the resistance of the coils is almost irrelevant, right? Because you could dunk this thing in liquid nitrogen so the coils are a superconductor, and it wouldn't really change, but it wouldn't change the current draw, right? You wouldn't actually lose much. So we've got rotor, stator, and the one drawback with these things is that they will flame out really fast if they're not spinning, because then you're just fighting the resistance, and they try and set up the resistance to be really low, because otherwise the thing acts like a heater instead of a motor. So if you want to control this thing. So, you need a pretty big source of amps, not really volts, right? This is still just 12 volts. It's the same voltage as a car battery or something. And there's virtually no electrocution hazard unless you embed the wires in your skin, and then you're more like cooking yourself. I mean, it's really much less hazardous than you might think. So 12 or 24, I'm not really that scared about, like, you know, just randomly glomming wires on. Now, it's a heck of a lot easier to deal with if we have some sort of control circuit. So in particular here, I've got something we use all the time for the robotics project. It's basically just a switch, and it's hooked itself to the Arduino. That's later. So all that's happening here is I pull DC in here. And then I've got a bidirectional switch that's wired up in a kind of hard to interpret fashion there. Yeah, I don't really know what's happening there either. Actually, I think in particular, input voltage goes to the two middle terminals, and then I can pull off output voltage either same polarity, like red to red, or black to red. So the idea is I should be able to reverse the flow of the motor. So all I'm going to do is hook this up with my current monitor. It's actually really handy for testing these things out briefly. If you've got a set of alligator clips to just grab onto the terminals, definitely makes it easier to run tests. So theoretically this should be relatively safe. So I can basically just spin it, and this is going to be really hard to see. So I'm spinning one way. I guess you could see the motor like jerk in my hand. Jerks the other way. Right, same way, and the other way. I think this is why it was making that squealing sound. I don't know what that is. I think that may be a chunk of grit crammed somewhere inside there. Oh no, the reason this is my demo motor is this little brash bushing at the top is actually worn out, so there's just a little bit of slop in the it's feeling a little bit. So if the rotor starts bouncing around, it tends to it hits something or other makes it make an awful squealing sound, and then it starts to really wear it wears that bushing even faster. Ball bearings would be better, although I've never seen them in a little tiny motor like this. It might be the brushes are literally rubbing against the commutator there, so the brush is usually a chunk of like graphite, and they're slowly getting worn down, and the commutator's slowly getting worn down. The thing's it's not really gonna last forever. I guess nothing lasts forever. I can show you this thing spinning, but this is like not real obvious like what what is happening there when it spins. So it turns out there's a much easier way to see what's happening, which is to put this is exactly a brushed DC motor right in the box here, and the brushed DC motor is connected to a little gear train that is connected to a threaded rod that runs up through here, and then the threaded rod has a little nylon nut on it that actually is supposed to move this thing in and out. This is called a linear actuator. They're about $60 or something. They're used for pushing like a solar panel or a wind turbine around, so that they're fairly cheap, kind of a nice commodity item. Let's see, double check. So this one is rated for 12 volts. So there it is. And so all I'm going to do is I'm going to grab onto this red, black to black. Now, so if I run current through one direction, nothing happens because it's fully retracted. So you can hear that, the motor is spinning in there, and then we have the linear actuator is slowly extending. You can see how slow it is, right? Like, that's kind of, like, boringly slow. It's only pulling 0.3 amps at 12 volts. So, you know, if I push the current through the other way, everything runs backwards and it will just go and retract. So you can see that if I push current through one way, push current through the other way, like, nothing much changes. It's just we go backwards. Super important thing about linear actuators: what happens at the end of the travel? So I told you this thing, like, there's a threaded rod with a little nut on it that goes up and down. What happens when a threaded, like a nut, hits the end of its travel?
It comes off,
or it stops. Tightens down and holds parts together, or it tears parts. So let's find out what happens here. So there's two switches in these. There's one at the top and one at the bottom. They are both totally mission critical. Same deal. I run the current through the other way. The linear actuator extends. So there we are. And hopefully at the end of the travel, it just stops. And essentially all that happens here, there's a little switch that opens. And then you can only power the motor the opposite direction. It's got a little diode to make sure that it only goes that way. Super duper important. We had a set of these for the robotics project, where if they were mounted not very well, the nylon nut like didn't quite hit the end stop. And what happens is this gearbox actually shreds itself. Like, literally steel parts are crushed to death inside there, and then you have to take it all apart and then make new parts and then reassemble the gearbox, and that's definitely sort of a frustrating, annoying situation. So linear actuator, and again, it's, you can see this motor's about the same size. It actually pulled fewer amps. It's rated for 12 volts. Would you expect linearity?
Yes.
Well, there's one way to find out. So I'm going to try and leave the data sheet, so if I can. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to stack up, and this starts to seem a little scary. This is a little scary. So what I'm going to do is black to red. So I've got 12 volts coming from the battery, and I've got 12 volts coming from the power supply. So now the question is, I'm going to hook up, oh my gosh, trying to figure out which one is now red is somewhat tricky. So black to black. It's actually really easy to power things backwards. Now I really need two bigger jumpers here. I think actually, so I can measure the voltage here. I took my glasses off for some reason. That's probably a bad idea. So looking at voltage, and if I basically stack the voltage, I should get, 24. So the voltages have stacked properly. And basically all I'm doing, this is one thing that's actually a little hard to do with Andersons properly. This looks really super duper goofy. Great way to destroy things if you're not absolutely sure of what you're doing. This is actually why the current monitor is not in there, is because trying to make sure you get the polarity right is a little trickier this way. I just realized that downstairs in the robot there's a basically a series stacking set of Anderson connectors that for some reason we're not using. Okay, so I don't have any way to measure current, but we should be able to see a difference. So remember, it took a few seconds to get up and down. So, okay, does that look like it's moving faster?
Yeah.
So that's true. What happens when we're near the end?
It's going to hit that stop a little bit quicker.
It's gonna hit the stop faster. So we actually did an experiment. We had a stack of lithiums, and we ended up running at 72 volts. Which meant the things were, these were going, woo, woo, and then the these parts of the motor were spinning. It was either, I don't know if it was the start current or the fact that they were spinning really fast. These basically tore themselves apart. It's kind of depressing. This is true for a lot of stuff. So actually, we run a lot of the parts on the big mining robot at 24 volts, even though they are rated for 12 volts. And engineers just hate this. So there are certainly parts that will immediately be destroyed if you exceed their voltage rating. Actually, like a capacitor, like these capacitors used to smooth out voltage. Capacitors are typically, if you double the voltage beyond their voltage rating, they will spit fire and not be capacitors anymore. So. You definitely can't do this willy-nilly. Turns out a brushed DC motor, the idea is, what am I doing with the voltage? Well, I'm mostly fighting inductance in the coils, right? That's actually, and it turns out if I push twice as hard, right, I fight that inertia twice as much, and the thing spins twice as fast. Now, you do have to be very careful. So we've run these motors, rated at 12. They will flame out in about 10 seconds at 12 volts if they're stalled, right? So even if you're on the data sheet, if they're not rotating, it's bad news. So you have to put in software like stall detection. So it's got like an encoder, sees if it's moving, if it's not moving, gives it more juice, and then says, okay, we're not moving, we gotta change something else.
Yeah. 3 minutes.
And actually, the right thing to do is just back up. Typically, like if your drive motors are just wedged against a rock and you can't drive up, drive backwards. And that simple fix for that stuff. At 24 volts, they flame out in just a few seconds. Usually the flaming out is so violent we don't really know how long it takes. So basically your software stall detection has to be pretty much dialed in and nailed. We could probably run them at 48, and the speed, the power, the control, all that stuff goes up, but like the chances of catastrophic failure start going up. I guess at some point you're going to get arcing in the windings. There are other limits on voltage, but I think it's pretty dang high actually. So questions about brushed DC motors. What other stuff do I want to talk about here? Because we pretty much this is a complete control system for a robot, circa 1950, right? I have wires going to the parts. Where's my my laptop is just streaming video. I have an Arduino, but it's not hooked into anything. So, obvious question. How do I hook up a brushed DC motor to something other than a manual control system? Something didn't like that. Love relays, actually.
You monitor your voltage and current and
working.
Okay. For how long?
So a
relay is great. It's actually it's a switch with an electromagnet that switches the switch. It's like super duper simple. It means it switches. So
12 volts and switch a 100 volt circuit.
Yeah. Actually, the thing I really love about relays is that the relay is just this coil of wire that then can switch as many, you can get a 100 amp relay pretty cheap. They're heavy, but they're simple, right? Because it's just like, yeah, got a big coil of wire and it switches, two plates of metal together. Like there's nothing fancy happening in there. They will slowly degrade as the plates that do the connections will arc and slowly degrade. I mean, they're super duper simple. So relay is a great way to do this. Now the problem with the relay is that like a 12 volt relay usually takes like 500 milliamps through the coil because it's got, you already got to physically move something, like and that's so in particular, like the current requirements for the motor are like, you know, 10 or 100 amps. The current requirements for a relay are like, you know, a substantial fraction of an amp. Now, the problem is like digital outputs. Like if you look at what's on an Arduino. So okay, so I think it's safe to get rid of most of these. You notice I'm kind of scared by even manipulating all this stuff in some weird new way. Because not totally sure what's going to happen. Famous story. We have this bidirectional switching box, right? That basically takes red to red and black to black, or red to black and black. And it'll drive it either direction, which for DC motor works perfectly fine. Again, if you take a digital system and you make it go the wrong way, it kills everything immediately. So there's a funny story about that that I'm going to hope to not repeat today. So okay, we got an Arduino. We haven't talked about Arduino. Actually, I got a whole probably lecture on Arduino. So this is the scaled down version. So Arduino plugs into USB. So right now it's powered by USB. You can get a little bit more power if you feed in VIN. And surprising cool thing about this, like I've got a little serial protocol on there called Fermata. This is not something I built. It was a built-in default thing. The little plugs on the Arduino are called pins. So we've got pins 4, 5, 6, 7 are all hooked up to LEDs. So cool thing about a Arduino is that it's got enough oomph that basically if I just command this thing over the serial port and so I can set pins 4, 5, 6, and 7. So I can actually turn these on. Oh, I'll be darned. So basically, if I send a digital command on a PC, I can change that port to be an output, and then I can see what's happening with the next one. Okay, there we go. So I can turn LEDs on and off. So that's cool. Right now, I've got enough oomph to do that. And if you read the data sheet, let's see, somewhere I got a data sheet. This is the data sheet for the Arduino. So you're thinking like, okay, maybe I could just drive a motor straight from the Arduino. I mean, that would be nice. Just say, hey, you, go, turn the motor.
If it's a microscopic Arduino.
Current per pin, 40 milliamps, 40 thousandths of an amp. We need like 10 amps. I wonder if that would work.
No.
Maximum operating voltage, the input voltage is 6 volts after the regulator. Well, we kind of want 12. 6 would mean we're turning half as fast anyway. There actually are motors that are so tiny you can turn them straight from logic pins. I wanted to save this, so I haven't tried this because I'm pretty sure it'll kill either parts of the Arduino or parts of the motor. Probably the Arduino would be the one really in the line of fire. So let's find out. I mean, this is like the tiniest conceivable motor, right? When I measured the static current draw on this thing, at 5 volts, it was only 50 milliamps, which is just a little bit beyond the data sheet.
Motors that don't take microscopes to see.
There are smaller motors, yes.
There are always smaller
motors. I've never played with one. Okay, so what we got here is we get red and green. So I'm just use pins 8 and 9, and I'm going to have to remember, actually, I should use pins that I may never want to use again. So somewhere in here, like 30 and 31 out in the boonies. Okay, so pins 30 and 31 are have the motor connected. So cross your fingers. This is for science. Oh my gosh. And what happens if I do it the other way? Do I destroy everything? Well, we'll find out. No, spins the other way. Okay, so if both of these are outputting low, in other words, they output 0 volts. What if they're both outputting high? Oh, there's no potential difference across the. I got two wires in the motor. So basically, like, if they're both high, there's no current is going to flow. If I have one high, one low, flows one way. one low, one high flows the other way. So this is how easy this could be, right? It's literally two wires plugged into the microcontroller. I'm surprised the microcontroller survived that, actually. Oh, I can feel a little bit of warmth on the microcontroller, which is not normally a good sign. But that worked surprisingly well. So let's go a little bit more. So really cool part about a microcontroller is that You know what? Since that worked, I'm going to switch to pins 8 and 9. Okay, I'm in pins 8 and 9 now, so let's go to pins 8 and 9. So make sure that it's a robot now. It's walking across the table. Cool. So let's see. So I can actually. So there's pins 8 and 9, and PWM is called pulse width modulation. And see if I can make that work. So this actually gives me speed control. So I can go really slow, and basically all it's doing is giving little blips of power out to the thing. So I can go really slow or really fast. Not that fast, I guess. So So what are the limitations of this? I mean, this is actually it's hopefully you can see it's really direct, right? Like I got wires coming out of the microcontroller that go to the motor. Like that's it. That's how it works. So you really got to worry about that current limitation. You really got to worry about like overheating your microprocessor. Seems okay. Actually, PWM is probably kinder on it. PWM, it's pulse width modulation. So it'll give it like really short blips. That's a narrow pulse, or really big fat. Like gonna turn it on for a while. Similar to how like on the old Nintendo controllers, there's no analog, right? So if you want to feather something, you just kind of go tap 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 tap. Or you give a little teeny taps. This really couldn't. Hopefully this couldn't be simpler. Hope this makes sense. What's happening on here? Does this make sense? It just stopped. This is precisely what I was afraid of. This is the danger of going off the data sheet. So we went off the data sheet on this DC motor because this thing is a big dumb hunk of metal. Right, and you can go over voltage and it doesn't really care enough. The inside the microprocessor is like silicon magic. I may have just killed this output pin. Oh no, did I kill the PWM circuit? PWM. Oh yeah. So. Okay, lots of nonlinearity here. So, for example, we see that max PWM, we're giving a lot of power and it turns. And if I have it turning and I start slowing that motor down, like I can make this thing turn really slow. I can actually feel it moving pretty effectively. So I can make this thing turn like appallingly slow at really low PWMs, and that's cool as long as it stays turning. Like I think it is actually still just barely creeping along. If I stop it, basically there's a gear train that goes from the super fast RPMs. These are, I don't know how visible those are. There's like a little tiny like clockwork gear train. There's about a five stages of reduction, probably several thousand fold reduction. So that gear train actually, if I go and I bring the PWM back up to half strength, that's not enough to make the motor turn the gear train. And I got to get it up in here for the gear train to actually stop. And then if I slow down again, I can actually have the thing continue turning. Okay, I just felt it stop. So the question is, if I'm slowly raising the PWM, it starts fairly low. Depends on where it is. Okay, so this is a really here I'm cooking the motor and I'm cooking the Arduino potentially. So you can see I got a lot of PWM going out. It's not turning because the gear train is kind of that's a sticky spot in the gear train, and I got to really max it out to get it to start turning. And once it starts turning, I can crank this thing way down, and it keeps turning and it goes past that sticky spot, and that's okay. Does this make sense? In other words, there's a lot of this stuff where the debugging, you got to understand the electrical, the hardware, the software, all this stuff can go horribly wrong, and the net result is robot no move. So we can do direct logic control, and the cool part of a direct logic control is it's actually really easy for me to show what's happening here. And I can do PWM on either side. What if I do PWM on both sides? So before the thing runs away. So what's happening here? So I'm doing little blips of power on pin 8 and pin 9. Now remember that if they're both low or they're both high, there's no spinning if it's low, right? Because that's like, you know, 0 volts on both sides of the motor. And if it's 0 volts on if it's 5 volts on both sides of the motor, it still doesn't turn, right? You gotta have a potential difference for it to turn. If the potential is one way, it turns one way. If the potential is the other way, it turns the opposite direction. So to get bidirectional control, we need some difference. So if I do PWM, I guess I could, so this is a little bit weird. I could do PWM and now I have like inverted PWM. So this is always zero. And I do blips of one, and when it's blips of one, basically the motor isn't turning anymore. Right? And as I close in on blips of zero, because I'm doing this relative to the other pin, which is high, and then if I drop this low, it'll turn the opposite direction more and more. Way. So does it make sense? Okay. The only problem with this is that I am stuck with 40 milliamps according to the data sheet. I think I'm probably getting 50 out. Actually, it seems like this is one of the interesting things about microcontrollers. Actually, I've been really impressed by Arduinos. I think in my lifetime, I have killed about 4 pins on an Arduino. And in particular, like if we try and pull more current, if we stuff in more voltage, like if I hook up 12 volts to an input pin on an Arduino, I mean, according to the data sheet, this is the absolute maximum. Like if you exceed this, like who knows, right? Anything could happen at that point. So it's totally within its rights to just stop working entirely. In particular, like if you hook up the supply voltage backwards, right? So voltage on any pin with respect to the ground pin, if it exceeds like that silicon's conduction threshold, basically, if it goes negative, like all bets are off. Like this thing could be permanently dead. And I've definitely had a lot of other things die. Arduino actually, in general, a chip that's designed for people to hook up. It's supposed to live in like a anti-lock brake controller or a microwave oven or something that, you know, usually has a lot of failure modes that are pretty scary to contemplate. So they tend to be really robustly designed devices, and in particular, most of them that I've seen are set up so if you overvoltage a pin, that pin's dead. But you may not kill the whole microprocessor. You may not kill you can see all this stuff is hooked up via USB. And there's Chris Palmer, who is one of the founding guys designing 3D printers in their garage. He managed to have he had like a AC powered, like 120 volt AC hot end. And he managed to have a short circuit between his hot end wire and his thermistor wire. So he basically was pumping 120 volts into the microcontroller. The microcontroller like fused out and conducted 120 volts into his USB, which conducted into his PC, which actually fried his whole stack basically, and that's something that can definitely happen. A lithium battery definitely has the oomph to really like just shred everything you got. The 12 volts kind of save you, and I presume there's some carefully designed like there's almost like a fuse built into the wiring on the microprocessor chip, because I basically had some of these where, you know, we've killed TX3. Like, you know, there's one serial port that doesn't work on that microprocessor, but everything else, everything works fine. I guess I should point out one thing in particular: semiconductor stuff, like the little light-emitting diodes that use silicon, they tend to be really persnickety about which direction the current's flowing. So you notice we can turn on these LEDs by putting one low and one high. Of course, high doesn't work, and low high doesn't work. It's not like this. By all rights, this should now be a light absorber. Like you have to shine light on it for there to be no light, or something. That's not the way it works. So basically, like current has to flow only one way, But you can actually do the same like PWM thing, so I can do analog brightness control on my little LED if I do a PWM drive. But if you hook up basically any semiconductor kind of device backwards, it's not going to be a semiconductor device anymore. It's scrap at that point. So if you want to exceed the current ratings on a microprocessor, what you need is you just need some kind of switching element that can suck down more current than what you're giving it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and upgrade here. So this is definitely a lesson on why you should make the leads really short, because the leads are way too long on this. So what I've got, and this is a little bit frustrating, this sort of thing oftentimes. We've got, I have too many wires happening for you to see even what the heck we got. So I've got a separate board here. So the separate board is a motor controller board, and I think the Arduino was from the original board design. So these are BTS, these are basically field effect transistors, like pretty beefy, they're designed to switch big motor current. You can actually see, oftentimes you can figure out some guesstimate, if I look at this battery, I can see that these little logic pins and this motor, the motor connector, you know, these Anderson connectors are they're rated, I think, for 50 amps. And these jumpers are maybe pushing it to put 1 amp through them. So you can usually get some guesstimate based on the size of the wires. So in this case, there's some pretty big, beefy power connectors up top. And then there's little tiny pins where we plug in, those are little headers where we're supposed to plug in jumper wires to basically make we make the electrical connection over jumpers. So you get the logic side, and there's a little tiny, this basically just does some inversion and a little bit of current monitoring, and then drives the big beefy power switching stuff that basically just, so we get two inputs. So we take one input from the battery, and that's your chunky amps. There's my chunky amps coming in and chunky amps going out to the motor. So in theory, we should be able to just hook this thing up to even a big scary high power motor. Maybe one of these ought to do. Didn't realize the terminals are kind of dead on that squealy one. So we get output terminals hooked up. I should hook up the input terminal. Actually, but before I plug in the power, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna make sure the control setup is actually all ready to go. So this is where we start getting just too many wires running around in every direction. I think I'm actually gonna just get the breadboard out of here. We'll just fewer wires involved. Okay, so what we have is we have power and ground, basically to power all the logic side of this. This is called a motor driver chip. Motor driver circuit board, and its job is to drive a motor, as you might expect. So let's see. So to get the digital signal over, I'm going to need to have a common ground connection. So I'm going to just hook the ground up to the Arduino ground, and I'm going to power the thing from Arduino 5 volt. Okay, and then I just have two more wires, and the idea is these wires are actually just the scaled copy of my output motor wire. Right, so if I put in zero on my logic side input, that corresponding motor wire is going to be at 0 volts. And if I put in a logic one, then I'm going to get all of battery voltage. So we should theoretically this should work exactly the same. We'll find out. So I'm going to do pins 8 and 9 again. So there we are, and I'm double checking to make sure I didn't kill everything. So now I'm just gonna hook this up to my current monitor so I can verify that I've got good voltage coming in, and then we can read off the amps when we're actually driving. Okay, there we are, and so I've got hopefully everything ready to go here. So pins 8 and 9. Oh, I got a PWM ready to go. Let me just do the PWM and nothing. Okay. So if I give it juice, this one sounds even worse. Man, these must be my scrap motor bin here. So basically, I could do hard output, and it's going to spin one way and the other way. Sounds a lot worse going one direction. Man, that hurts. So I can spin it each direction, and I'm immediately realizing I should probably do the linear actuator so we can see which direction it's going. Silly question. What would happen if I brushed these two wires together? Well, so basically, current would be coming out of the motor controller and then shorting and going back into the motor controller. So that may be more amps than the motor controller can handle. So what I'm gonna do is unplug the analog power. You notice the Arduino's still up, and like setting up the software and stuff is kind of a pain. So I'm not gonna unplug that side. So I'm just gonna plug the beefy power connector. And now basically not a whole lot can go wrong, even if I accidentally blip the software side. So, linear actuator, and I'm just gonna stuff these in here. Oh, and this is making me realize what would happen if these two connectors brush together. Well, bad news. I thought I had tape. Apparently I didn't bring my tape, so that's annoying. I think I'm gonna try and prop them apart with a jumper or a paper separator. Okay, so hopefully we can just power that same linear actuator. Oh, that's visible. All my other stuff. Okay, we can do this. So cool, and nice. And it's nothing if they're both high. It's nothing if they're both low. We can do PWM, and we can slowly control the speed. I don't know why you'd want to do that, but so we can you can slow down before you reach the end, for example. Questions? Brushed DC motors. The idea is you just got to get chunky amps to them, and they spin like crazy. There's two wires. The current goes through one way, it turns one way, the other way, it turns the other way. There's nothing more to it than that. Most of our mining robot is all brushed DC motors. That's like that's what we use. Vacuum cleaner is often some kind of a brushed, actually the, you can hear the, so, commutation happening inside one of these things is—it's chunky and analog, right? There's these big currents flowing through these just brushes. This is like early 1900s technology. It's very, very crude. Actually, like a lot of early 1900s technology, it's simple. It's reliable. It wears out really quick. It's super powerful. It's not at all efficient. It makes a lot of noise. Like it just like gets job done. Maximum speed and all other considerations are secondary. There are more modern ways to do this. So what are the drawbacks with a brushed DC motor? I mean, they're loud. Like, I'm realizing there's a huge problem for Layla.
They're loud, they're not particularly efficient.
Yeah.
They're electronically noisy.
Yeah.
Brushes will wear out eventually.
Yep. Let's see. Oh, I hit the end of my travel. So this sound is, I guess part of it could be the gearbox, but a lot of it is just literally like the, we're making and breaking these connections to the coils, and we're making and breaking them in a, like a big, this sort of automated switch element happening there inside the brushes is pretty crude, really. The fact that there's this rolling contact is actually kind of a pain. You would think you'd be able to basically just have static coils on the outside and put a permanent magnet in the middle. And then it turns out that's actually great because then, there's no, you can make those things way quieter because there's no like moving connection. I mean, it just seems goofy to put like the, that's the illustration. The physical part is actually this like, you've got these little steel laminations there. You've got the coil of wire is rotating. If you spin too fast, centrifugal force can actually pull the the wires out and then shred things. Yeah.
Are those motors sensitive to like external magnetism?
Not very much. They have a big steel case around them.
Oh.
And actually, usually like if you stick a giant external magnet on,
if it's facing the same direction as the field, you've actually made the magnet stronger. Interesting. And again, like the early 1900s stuff, there's nothing fancy about them, right? Like they're like, it's not like it would screw up the control unit or something. Like, oh, there's an external magnetic field. Oh no, that messes up everything. Because like the brushes just brush, right? And they're going to conduct current through there no matter what. So basically, like, nice part about this: simple, high power, cheap. They seem to be pretty reliable. But the downside is, wear is a problem with these things. They are loud. If you want the one that's quiet, you put the coils on the outside. Okay, coils on the outside is great. You put like either permanent magnet or even actually just a non-magnetic piece of steel that will basically self-adjust. Then that's great. Now the problem is, if I had a permanent magnet on the inside and I have coils on the outside, I turn the coils on, and we're going to point at the magnet. So somewhere I got a simulation of this. So let's see. So we go. So if I say turn on the field, so basically like I get coils on the inside. I guess I drew it like they're on the outside again. So I got a rotor and a stator here. So I get to the coils on the outside are basically doing that. Now the problem is, in order to get this thing to actually turn, I can't just send current through one way, right? Sending current through one way picks a position for the rotor rather than a speed for the rotor. So if I send current through the other direction, this kind of this weirdly unstable, supposed to be unstable. Oh, okay. Once it gets moving, then it pushes, and light poles repel. So basically, I just by switching the polarity, now I selected a different position. But one set of coils, basically, I get two positions, and the inertia is going to cause the thing to overshoot. So this is actually not terribly useful. I don't know very many devices that use this. Main problem being like I don't have very good control over the rotation rate. Like if I switch from one to the other, it's just going to switch directions, but I don't really have control over the direction it's going to rotate. So for example, if I do this the other way, I just made the rotor switch rotate the opposite direction. So depending on how you time this thing, you can kind of push. So you can see that once you get it spinning, you can actually make it continue to spin in a reasonable way, just by what I'm doing here is I'm switching the current as the rotor is spinning. This takes a lot more kind of coordination finesse possibly than I have to get this to work. And then if I've only got one set of coils, like I can only make it spin in one direction. I gotta like somehow get it to like I gotta really time it to get it to spin the other way. And then I can apply forces the other way. So cool part about this is I could actually be doing electrical switching, which is quiet, and I actually have much better control over things. Although I got it. So now I got to know where the rotor is, so this is a censored brushed censored brushless motor. It's usually not. It doesn't have two coils. Actually, three coils gives you enough to be able to control the direction of rotation yourself. So a censored brushless three phase is a pretty common. It's actually the standard for UAVs in relatively high sizes. Little micro UAVs maybe would use a brushed, but any decent sized UAV uses a censored brushless. I haven't seen them very much in robotics. Making the sensors work if you don't just have a pure inertia like a prop, like if it's it's moving a robot arm or something, it's actually a lot harder to make the sensors work out. So one more pole actually gets you what is called a stepper motor. So this is a model of a four-phase stepper motor. So it's actually just WASD here. So essentially, I can say I want the red pole on the rotating part to be on the left. Okay, now I want it to be up. Now I want it to be right. Now I want it to be down. Now I want it to be left, up, right, down. And I can basically just push this thing along. And it doesn't really show it here, but these a stepper motor actually it's called hogging. So stepper motor, so I think we are done with the Arduino for now. So same exact deal, like
from one point of view, this is actually just two DC motors. Like so there's four wires here, which is always scary. You're like, man, I don't even know. Two of those wires go to one set of coils in here, and two of them go to a set of coils that's 90 degrees off of it, essentially. So if I just send chunky amps through one direction, basically that sets one position for this rotor, and if I send chunky amps through on the other set, that sets the adjacent position, and then I just do that that same thing the other with the other polarity. And then I can actually so this is called a stepper motor because it's got these discrete steps. And if I leave current flowing through this thing, it wants to hold on here, right? Then there's holding torque, so it's going to want to not keep rotating. So again, we've just got and basically like my two wires, they go through this coil and then this coil, and then that's one pair of wires, and then same deal with these two going through. I've drawn it like these poles are 90 degrees apart, which actually would be really chunky, right? Like I, you know, when I do my rotations, a 90 degree step size would be a really huge, like, oh, clunk, clunk, clunk. So usually what they do is they have this exact same idea, and they have this awesome magnetic way to sort of gear this thing up. So essentially, it's just like there's like four poles. It's usually 1.8 degrees of rotation. So you need to do essentially like 200 complete cycles through this thing in order to get the stepper shaft to go all the way around. So these things, these are great. They sound a lot like robots. Okay, can I make this work? So it takes a little more current than you wanted to supply straight from a microprocessor. That's pretty typical. So what I got is... So this is a 3D printer control board, and it's got you got USB coming out, so I can just plug it straight into PC and drive it directly, which hopefully I'm doing in a sec. It's got a bunch of tie downs, so it's got a big chunky input for the battery. It's got I don't know how visible any of those things are. It's got a big chunky output for the so a big chunky input for battery battery voltage. We've got the heated bed. We've got the hot end resistor. We've got a big fan. Let's see, and then it's got a bunch of sensors for like end stops. So we'll see how those work in a sec. I had to actually hotwire these with thermistors because if the firmware starts up and it sees there's no thermistor attached, it's like nope, just stops doing anything. It's afraid of powering up anything if the thermistor fell off. So super duper important. So if I plug this baby in, so we have four wires coming out of the I've called this the y-axis, I guess. So hopefully if I've gotten the wires correct, then basically all we do is just plug the wires into the stepper motor, and we should be able to make this thing step and hold in position. And we can actually use the printer control code. The wires are slightly bigger than the holes. I guess that means this connection should be pretty reliable. Of course, I'm doing all this with the battery or the supply voltage unplugged. So I guess I should probably actually just plug into the PC power supply here, just to get the current correct, rather than the plug into the battery. That way I automatically get some crowbar protection. Okay, so I plug in, it's pulling basically no current. My stepper basically isn't doing any stepping. I don't know how visible any of this stuff is going to be. Okay, so we got the... I got a stepper. Maybe I'll just do it like that. So stepper motor, and then I'm gonna go here and hopefully send it some software commands. Okay, we get power. So hopefully, the printer control software here is Prompterface. And try and get it all set up. Okay, so do a connection. It's claims, connecting. Oh, that just killed cheese. Awesome. Okay, so we got the webcam. We got
I've thought about it for a disturbingly long time, and then finally, okay, so we, on this printer control board is actually, it's a whole set of firmware. I'm using the Marlin firmware, and just tiny configuration fixes there. The device is actually an Arduino. Like this particular one is not like a Mega. It's like one step back from the Mega to save money for some reason. So if I power this up and I move my Y axis, I think I hooked this up to the Y axis. Basically, you can see I can take little steps of 1 millimeter at a time or 100 millimeters, and I can take little tiny steps. Negative 0.1 millimeters on Y. I think I told it it's a huge print bed, so no problem there. You can see that we're actually getting readouts from the thermistors that are hooked up to these phantom beds. So for example, if I heat this thing up in my fingertips, see the temperatures should start to change there. Yeah, so from 60 centigrade to 66 centigrade, I never calibrated these thermistors. This is like my just debug thermistor, just to get the firmware to start up properly. So essentially, all that's happening here, we're sending out current to these four wires. And that's making the stepper hold position. This is something that's hard to show you remotely. So basically, this rotor's in a particular position, and I don't know if I can get it to rotate. It's stronger than I am at this point. So if I tell it to turn motors off, you notice nothing looks like it's changed. But now I should be able to just rotate. Yeah, so I can. It turns out I can rotate this shaft. You can't see the shaft at all, so I'm gonna mark the shaft. Okay, so there's the tip of the shaft, and I can rotate that thing with just finger pressure, no problem. And then if I take a step, that actually locks it. Again, nothing changed there, but back driving it is more than I can do with the shaft is small, and it's not that my fingers are appallingly weak. Yeah, I can't touch that thing. And it's we're only pulling like 0.1 amps, so 0.1 amps. And the shaft is tiny. If it had a giant lever arm, I'd be able to pop it back and forth. We saw, I guess, one of the first lectures. I was just pushing the steppers back and forth. Good and bad thing about steppers: you don't need anything else, right? Like if I do steppers, I can actually do super accurate motion control, like go forward by 10, boom, there's 10, here, go backward by 10, and it's back where it started, right? Forward by 10, and it took like, let's see, I guess a quarter rotation would be 90 complete revolutions. So doing this, it would be like, go around 90 cycles, and the timing is really important on this. So you essentially you send this cool wacky control signal. The waveform that it does for the control signal is actually really really important. Like if you send the wrong waveform, essentially this does not actually work. We're going to so for example, if I say go up forward down sideways, like if I'm sending the coil voltages faster than the rotor can keep up, the rotor doesn't move, it just kind of sits there humming and vibrating, right? Like up, down, sideways, up, down, sideways, up, down, sideways. So it doesn't actually follow, right? And in particular, a stepper will stay locked on as long as like the speed that you're trying to tell to turn the stuff, and stuff is able to keep up with that. And if not, so usually when I'm tuning a 3D printer, I'm doing things like setting the maximum speed, so we should be able to set like, and you can do this all in G code if you remember how, which is kind of marginal at this point. Solution. Okay, so somewhere. Man, this thing is not designed for the range of screen sizes I've asked of it here. So if I G0, Y equals 0, I think I have acceleration pretty dang high, so I can do a huge feed rate, so I can tell, like, get there, and it spins all the way to Y equals 0, and I can do spin, to, set to Y equals 10, and boom, it zips down there. you can try different distances and sizes. So for example, if I go to y equals 300, that's quite a ways, and it's spinning. So this is assuming I have belts of a particular diameter. You set this in the config file. So the belts would basically move the print bed down there. If I slow down the feed rate and I go back to zero, let's see, I think I'm not going to slow it down quite that much. It's gonna turn back, and it's gonna turn back slowly. And of course, who wants slow, right? Everybody wants everything should be happening faster. But if you tell the stepper to move faster than the mechanicals can keep up, basically the stepper is going to lose steps. It's going to make horrible crunching sound as it can't quite get there fast enough. Ah, there is a G code to set the acceleration, which I think is M201. So let me do a M201. So I'm setting the y-axis acceleration to huge. And because there's nothing on here, I actually could probably manage that level of acceleration. So I can do y equals 300, and it's going to do, that was plenty fast. So if you can imagine, if I've got a big, high inertia device there, in particular, like the Alaska 93 printer bed weighs 20 pounds. It's on this little belt that gets pulled back and forth. And I had to crank these, so you can see my default acceleration here. X, which is basically just the hot end, has acceleration of 9,000 millimeters per square second. And the Y-axis acceleration is like a tenth that, right? Because it's got to go woo. So let me see if I can turn the acceleration way down so you can hear what that sounds like. So let me do acceleration of 10. And this should sound like a robot here. So I'm gonna tell it to go to high speed, back to zero. So it slowly speeds up faster and faster and faster and faster and faster. And then it starts slowing down as it approaches the target position. I'm surprised how little noise these are making. These same steppers hooked up to the big robot, I guess there's more opportunity for them to make noise. Yep. Yeah. So you can see that acceleration value is actually really important. If I've got a big heavy object to move around, a little stepper, I gotta speed up slowly and then slow down slowly, or else I end up losing steps. In particular, in the middle. So let's see. So if I go up to, I'm gonna crank up my acceleration by a factor of 10, and I'm going to go. So F is the feed rate, is the maximum speed, and I'm going to go basically all the way across the bed. So it's actually, you can hear there's like a resonance or something. There's some intermediate point where it starts to vibrate across the table, so you want to skip by that or clamp it so you never get into that area. So I don't know if you can see, does this make sense? Like you dial in the acceleration, set the feed rate, and it's going to slow down as it approaches the target. And this is crucially important on a stepper, because basically if I tell it to step to a position, and then I tell it to step to the next position, I tell it next to step to the next position, and if it can't keep up, I'm not going to be in the right spot. And you end up having that's bad for robotics or 3D printers, or no one likes that. Questions? So steppers, DC motors, you usually need some sort of driver circuit to get the chunky amps out to them. I'm hoping to do Arduino, where we'd actually write some code on Arduino to command these things to do stuff. How many people have laptops where we can, because I got enough Arduinos. So if you can bring in, so download the Arduino IDE, I bring in a laptop, I can bring in an Arduino for you, and some simple little toys to make things happen. Cool. Oh, and there is a homework, do an OpenSCAD design, do Tuesday. Hopefully, we'll be able to print soon enough.
I didn't have a question mark. Can I borrow it after? For the arms.